I'm in New York, in Midtown Manhattan, right in the heart of Broadway, and if you ever wanted to see a musical, this is the place to come. The old classics like Carousel and My Fair Lady are still bringing in the crowds. Over in the Majestic Theater, Andrew Lloyd Webber's Phantom of the Opera has been running for 30 years, and in the Ambassador, Chicago has been on for even longer. And people are selling their grandmothers to get a ticket to Hamilton. But if I'd been here 100 years ago, in the early decades of the 20th century, the man dominating the theaters and Broadway with his operettas and musicals was composer Victor Herbert. He had hit after hit, and his name was as well known as Andrew Lloyd Webber is today.
This is the composer that they coined the phrase, walk out of the theater humming. That's Herbert.
I mean, he was obviously a remarkable cellist himself.
He believed himself to be Irish. And he left a body of work that is clearly Irish.
And he was a supremely gifted orchestrator in a way that I underestimated.
I'm Guy Livingston. In this program, I'm exploring the life and music of a composer who has always fascinated me, Victor Herbert.
I've been working on reviving Victor Herbert since 1993 because I thought, this is the most glorious music I've ever heard in my life, period.
This is Alyce Mott, Artistic Director of the Victor Herbert Renaissance Project Live, in New York, and probably the greatest champion there is of Victor Herbert's work. She has presented 36 performances, revived dozens of operettas and countless songs, and provides performance materials for musicians from all over the world. Victor originally trained as a musician in Germany, but he spent the vast majority of his career and had his greatest success in the U.S. But he might never have gone to the United States and ended up in New York if it hadn't been for his wife's career. She was Therese Forster, a prima donna. They met in Stuttgart in Germany in August 1855 when she walked on stage for a rehearsal of the court opera. Victor was playing cello in the orchestra and was smitten by her beauty. He immediately wrote to her and proposed accompanying her at the piano, but she turned him down. He persisted, and eventually the diva fell in love with her handsome admirer. Victor wrote her poetry. And now you're here among us, Teresa good and kind. May all good things await you, the words I cannot find. To tell you all my gladness, my happiness and bliss. Stay here and dwell among us all, but save for me your kiss. Perhaps it's just as well that he stuck with music.
Herbert falls in love with her. He courts her for about a year and finally convinces her to marry him. And then she gets a job offer from the Met, specifically from Anton Seidel and Walter Damrosch, who were co-music directors of the Met at the time. She said, but you have to bring my husband. So they put him in the orchestra pit.
Teresa and Victor were to spend the rest of their lives in the U.S. Teresa's career as a prima donna with the New York Metropolitan Opera began very well.
She had 4 or 5 major debuts and got reviews that were out of this world, and the divas of the Met, I'm sure, played a little politics.
So did envious divas push Teresa out of the Metropolitan Opera? Could be.
Either that, or she was absolutely amazed that her husband was the talent that he was, and she knew he was going far, and she wanted to devote herself to him.
Victor did not languish in the orchestra pit for long.
Within weeks of getting there, he caught the attention of Theodore Thomas, Anton Seidel, and Walter Damrosch. And they were all fighting over who was going to get him as an assistant. Because not only could he arrange music for them, but he was an extremely talented cellist. He was the Pablo Casal of his day.
But while these top three conductors all wanted him as their assistant, Herbert wanted to be his own man and lead his own musicians. He soon got his chance. At the end of the 19th century, band music was huge, and one of the most popular bands of the time was the 22nd Regiment Band, which had been around since the Civil War. It was conducted by an Irish-American, Patrick Gilmore. But when Gilmore died, the band was in trouble.
Finally, Herbert was hired to save that band. So from 1892 to 1900, Herbert conducted Gilmore's band and loved it and toured everywhere.
He had a gift for public relations. When he was touring, he was at his best, fraternizing with the musicians as they traveled with their own rail car. The train's bar was well stocked with schnapps and oysters, and their tours became legendary. When they arrived in town, Victor put on a fancy uniform and paraded at the head of the band. He was an American celebrity. One reviewer wrote about his conducting, "Herbert throws his whole soul and body into the music. His entire figure moves in sympathy with the rhythm, arms, shoulders, head, and even toes participating in the beat." Then in 1893, his friend William MacDonald asked him to write a light opera for his company. It was to be the turning point of Herbert's career. Prince Ananias opened in New York City in November 1894 and was a modest success. Undeterred by the tepid reviews, Victor pressed on and within a few years was composing hit after hit. Here's one of his most famous tunes from Naughty Marietta. This is the composer that they coined the phrase, walk out of the theater humming. That's Herbert. In the early years of the 20th century, Victor Herbert's songs dominated popular music, but then fell into relative obscurity until Alyce Mott founded a new organization to promote his music.
The Victor Herbert Renaissance Project Live is the performing side of my dedication to bringing Victor Herbert back to the American people.
Every year, the project puts on performances of Victor Herbert's compositions. In 2018, they chose a rare one, The Enchantress. Here are members of the cast rehearsing in New York.
All right, let's stop there. And Bo, let's go to... On page 8, the last page, the second, just start with the next.
The Enchantress is a comic operetta about Prince Ivan of Zergovia, who falls in love with an enchanting young opera singer. One of the best songs in The Enchantress is Art is Calling for Me. It's a brilliant song and one of Herbert's funniest. Here it is, performed by Kiri Te Kanawa.
Is a queen and papa is a king, so I am a princess and I know it. But court etiquette, it's a dull, dreary thing. I just hate it all and I show it. To see on the stage, it's the one life for me. My figure's just like Tetris CD. I know I'd win fame if I sang in Bohème. Opera by Signor Puccini. I've roulades and the trills that would send the cold chills down the backs of hearers of my vocal frills. I want to be a prima donna, donna, donna. I want to shine upon the stage. I have the embonpoint to become the queen of song, and my figure would look pretty as a peach. I want to be a screechy, peachy, counter-trinchy, like other fat girls that I see. I hate society, I hate propriety. Art is calling for me. Still, I do not fancy my position. I have not much use for the men that I meet. I just burn with lyric ambition. Those tenors, so sweet, if they made love to me, I'd be a success that I do know. And Melba I'd oust if I once sang Faust, that opera so charming by, you know. Would be on the brink of hysterics, I think. Even Strophon would have to go out for a drink. I want to be a prima donna, donna, donna. I want to shine on the stage with my avoirdupois and my tra la 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 la. I would be the chief sensation of the age. I want to hear them shouting Viva to the diva.
Viva!
Oh, very lovely that must be. That's what I'm sighing for. That's what I'm dying for. What is calling for?
Herbert's most famous and enduring operetta is Babes in Toyland. The original Broadway production ran for 192 performances. It was also twice made into a film, including one version with Laurel and Hardy and a second version featuring fellow Irish-American Ray Bolger. Alyce Mott is in no doubt of Victor Herbert's significance in the evolution of music theater.
Kern, Berlin, Rogers all grew up listening to Victor Herbert. He's the foundation of American musical theater.
Besides his talent and reputation as a composer of light music, Herbert could, and did, also writes substantial concert music and two grand operas. Natoma is the most important of these and is set in California with a libretto by Joseph D. Redding. When it premiered in Philadelphia in 1911, one of the most famous sopranos of the day, Mary Garden, starred in the title role, along with a young Irish tenor, making his operatic debut in the role of the lieutenant. That was John McCormick. We hear him now in this archival recording from Natoma.
My commander, then I bid me come to tender you his compliment and ask you to accept the good will of his government. Here upon this far off shore, where nature spreads with open arms the treasures of her seas, we would salute your sovereign flag, the noble pennant of historic Spain.
And we mustn't forget that Victor Herbert started out as a cellist. He wrote some splendid music for his favorite instrument.
The first time I heard of Victor Herbert was when I was asked to play the second concerto in E minor with the Ulster Orchestra.
This is William Butt, professor of cello at the Royal Irish Academy of Music. William has performed as a soloist and chamber musician all over the world. When he was asked to perform Herbert's second cello concerto, a work he'd never heard of, by an unfamiliar composer, the piece was a revelation.
There's just this incredible energy and drama and color. And in fact, I'm so impressed by the orchestral writing. There's this really dramatic minor ninth. If I could just even play the opening of the concerto to show that. Let's see. This kind of creates really from the outset a great drama. It's an incredible work to listen to and to play. I mean, he was obviously a remarkable cellist himself. So the second movement has this beautiful theme. It says Simplice, and it's quite gentle. But I think you can hear, he was born in Ireland, so I think in this theme particularly we can hear there's an influence there, an Irish influence. Thank you. it's something like that anyway, but you can hear this lovely, this gorgeous kind of rhapsodic quality, really. I hear an Irish influence there. It sounds like it may be a little... The little notes and everything, yeah.
William believes that much of that Irish influence must come from Victor Herbert's grandfather.
His mother's father was Samuel Lover, a celebrated Irish novelist and poet and composer. Third movement is even more drama, and he brings back the themes from the first and the second. Some of it is extremely difficult to play, but I'm just going to maybe try this section where that beautiful theme from the slow movement comes back. It says tutta forza, is in the full, with the full orchestra. This is coming towards the end of the work. It's extraordinary because of the depth and colour and energy, and in fact, I think it's brilliant writing. So it's a thrilling piece to perform. I can't wait to do it again, actually.
Victor Herbert himself performed his second cello concerto at its premiere in New York in 1898. At the time, he was on the faculty of the National Conservatory of Music in New York, where Antonin Dvorak was director. And yes, Dvorak attended the premiere.
And it's said that that influenced Dvorak, kind of spurred him to write his famous concerto in B minor, which is better known than Herbert's. But any cellist I've ever met who knows or who've tackled it, or who've played the Herbert, just loves it. It seems to be always a surprise that it's not more popular.
Victor Herbert did much of his composing at his country house on Lake Placid, about 5 hours' drive north of Manhattan, standing at a famous high desk, which is now enshrined in the Library of Congress. Alyce Mott has visited the house.
It's absolutely amazing. Four floors, sitting right on the lake. He had a studio where he did all his composing with a screened-in porch right off of it so that when he was working all night, he could go out. Or when it got too hot, he could go out.
Accounts of the time portray him as a larger-than-life figure. He drank, he ate, he dashed from meetings to rehearsals to banquets. He tipped lavishly, took care of his musicians, and always had a good story to tell. One of his favorite restaurants was Luchau's, which served hearty German food. My own mother and aunt remember eating there many years later.
Luchau's was like over-the-top German, red, thick curtains.
Banquettes in some corners.
The food was more than you could possibly eat, with lots of potatoes and gravy, and the food presentation was all so big.
Yeah. Everything was so heavy. Chairs, the table, the menus. I mean, it was just like gigantic, but it was very festive. It really was fun.
It was fun. It was definitely fun.
Victor Herbert's favorite dishes at Luchow's were boiled beef with horseradish sauce and wine kraut, veal chops au naturel, and sirloin steak fried over charcoal with grated horseradish, onions, and potatoes spread over it. Victor Herbert got his fondness for German food from his youth in Germany and his early years at the court orchestra, which involved much drinking. But the other influence on his life, and in my view, the major one, was Irish.
He loved Ireland.
His sense of who he was came from his mother and his Irish grandfather, Samuel Lover. Here's historian Marianne Casey, whom I met at her office at New York University.
The years he spent in his grandfather's house were absolutely critical to his understanding of his sense of ethnic identity and who he was in the world, where he had come from.
Nothing is known about Victor Herbert's father, but we know that Victor moved to England when he was only 2 years old to live with his grandfather, Samuel Lover, and his mother, Fanny.
She was the favorite of her father's, the one most like him. What she knew of Irish music and culture had come directly from her father, and it was passed down to her son.
And she was a musician herself.
Yes, she was, apparently a great pianist.
Yeah.
Samuel Lover was a big influence on his young grandson. He lived in England in a kind of artistic exile, surrounded by other Irish intellectuals. He was a painter, musician, and writer, best remembered for his novels Rory O'More and Handy Andy. Victor later described being exposed to music in his grandfather's house. The music they made of afternoons or evenings when singers or violinists or pianists dropped by for a little social time filled my soul with deep, peaceful satisfaction. There was, I recall, a cellist named Piotti. Oh, his music was the supreme thing for me. The longing to play a cello was lodged then and there in my soul. It took root and awaited its time. Victor described his mother, Fanny, as vivid, independent, energetic, and eccentric. She spoke fluent German, Spanish, Italian, and French, and smoked cigars even in her old age. At parties, Fanny would play the piano and sing Irish folk songs to her young son. Herbert recalled that she used to sing them before I could even talk. Fanny and Victor moved to Germany when Victor was still quite young, so he grew up there, but no doubt, due in large part to the influence of his mother and his grandfather, his sense of Irishness was strong. When he later moved to the U.S. with his wife, Therese, his love for Ireland continued. He even painted the inside of his country house multiple shades of green. He was a fixture at St. Patrick's Day parades, always conducting an elaborate uniform. He was idolized by the Irish-American community in the States, and he returned the favor with a commitment to Irish causes and Irish freedom.
Herbert joined in. Herbert got all riled up, and because he was Victor Herbert, and because he was most well-known person in America who was Irish American, they listened. People listened. They suddenly made him president of organizations. He was president of two or three organizations. He was raising money left and right.
He's intentionally chosen to be the president of the Friends of Irish Freedom, a brand new organization, 6 weeks before the Easter Rising. I believe he was chosen so that because he was a nationally known name that could amplify the cause. And then the Easter Rising happens and the British execute so many men, and it sort of is a new catalyst for him. He uses music to express it. I mean, he's not a politician, he's a musician.
So Herbert's response was to write an Irish operetta, which he first called Hearts of Erin, but later changed to Eileen. He began writing it in 1916, not long after the Easter Rising, and it was premiered on New Year's Day in 1917.
Eileen's probably the most beautiful score, period. Why? Because every inch of his heart was in that score.
However, no recording existed of the full music of Eileen until it was recorded in Dublin in 2012 for New World Records, conducted by David Brophy.
I didn't know anything about Victor Herbert really until I was asked to conduct a recording of his operetta Eileen.
Like William Butt, whom we heard earlier, David was bowled over by the music.
Amazing music, actually. And one of the elements I think that attracts me to the score, and one of the things that I found in preparing the score and getting ready for recordings and actually recording himself, was how amazing his orchestration is. I mean, he was a supremely gifted orchestrator in a way that I underestimated hugely before I took on the project. It's so lush and it's so well written.
For the plot of his operetta, Victor Herbert turned to a novel by his grandfather.
He based it on a book by Samuel Lover called Rory O'More. Herbert gave that book to Henry Blossom, his librettist, and said, here's the story.
Henry Blossom faced quite a task to try to tell the story.
Rory O'More is a revolutionary figure. He meets a girl named Eileen. And he has a boyhood friend named Sean Reagan. And Sean Reagan has his eyes kind of set on this Eileen, too.
Eileen is the romantic interest of Barry O'Day, who's an informer against the British, against the backdrop of the 1798 rebellion, in largely taking place set in Wexford.
And the French are helping.
Got that? No, me neither.
I don't even understand it.
And perhaps we shouldn't really expect realism from Victor Herbert.
It is romanticized. In other words, the hardship of Ireland, Herbert never knew. So what he knew was the romantic side. And it all works out.
Thank goodness for that. But who cares about the plot when the music is so fine?
There's some great tunes, some really great tunes. He knows how to write a good aria, he knows how to write a good chorus, he knows how to write dramatic orchestral music in there. So the sound of it is completely ravishing, I think. But his orchestration, I think, is what lends itself to how fantastic the music is. We recorded it in the National Concert Hall, but it's amazing for me to sort of have a group of the plot, to know the chorus, to know all the arias, to know all the orchestral music, and to come in the first day with a bunch of musicians who don't know it at all. And we recorded very quickly. We rehearsed, recorded. I think it was recorded over maybe 3 days, 4 days. So it's very much a sprint for the players and the singers, who quickly have to learn everything. But it's amazing seeing their faces when we do numbers, and they go, wow, that's a great piece, actually, you know. And then stuff that's very twee and Irish, them laughing their heads off and saying how amazing it is to do this stuff that's like completely Irish, of a bygone era that we would never even think of performing nowadays ourselves, you know. There's a tune he takes from the operetta, It's a Great Day Tonight for the Irish, you know, bum 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 bum. And it is a bit like, you know, Inflatable Shamrocks and Paddy's Day, and you can sort of almost see like the little rosettes that we used to have, you know, like when we were going to the parade and that, you know. It's a bit like that.
Ireland was a nation from the time of Adam's fall, and 'twas never meant that we should be oppressed. But the Saxon tyrants took us once and robbed us of our all. They've been trying ever since to take the rest. But every loyal Irishman that's now alive or dead would give his life to set our wrongs to right. And this faithful little band here, together heart and hand here, may see the dawn of freedom break tonight. 'Tis a great day tonight for the Irish, for the cause we have fought for a night. And the time is soon to be when you see all Ireland free. 'Tis the land of our love and our pride. We despise and defy our oppressors and their tyrant laws we will fight.
But as fast as they can make 'em, be God, or we can break 'em. Sure, the Irish have a great day tonight.
Ways, you know, you would sort of say it's kind of Irish, O-I-R-I-S-H, Irish music, which I don't mind myself at all. Some people find that a bit sick, but I don't mind that at all. It's of its time, obviously.
It's just gorgeous music, and it's gorgeous Irish sentiment about the kind of people the Irish people are. Loyal, hardworking, opinionated, but true to Ireland. Nothing else. So that was Herbert's gift to Ireland.
The old-fashioned, or should I say corny, lyrics shouldn't lead us to overlook some beautiful music.
Yeah, there's that opening aria, My Little Irish Rose, which is beautiful. It kind of tugs at the heartstrings. And I can see how, at this stage, like, he wrote Eileen less than a decade before he died. He died 7 years after he wrote Eileen. And maybe he just reached the point in his life where he kind of wanted to connect with his homeland or his heritage, and maybe he saw Ireland as his homeland.
In 1915, Victor Herbert was in Shanley's restaurant in New York when they started playing his song Sweethearts on the player piano. At the time, restaurants were using piano rolls of popular and classical music without paying any royalties to the composer. This is pre-radio, pre-broadcast days. Every restaurant worth its salt either had live music or else a player piano in the corner. These mechanical instruments would play tune after popular tune. And though player pianos were taking over dance halls and saloons, there was a problem. Composers and musicians were earning nothing from this. Just exposure, and exposure doesn't pay the rent.
There was no laws. Even at 1911, when they started recording on cylinders, there was no law that said that any recorder had to get the composer's permission.
One version of the story is that hearing the recording of his tune Sweethearts being played on a piano roll in Shanley's restaurant was the last straw. Victor Herbert strode over to the pianola, grabbed the roll out of the machine, and smashed it to the floor. This led directly to Herbert, supported by such musical greats as Irving Berlin, Jerome Kern, and John Philip Sousa, founding ASCAP, the American Society of Authors, Composers, and Publishers, to protect the rights of authors and composers.
So I'm Guy Livingston.
What a pleasure to meet you.
Here at ASCAP. Thank you.
Yeah. We're here at the head offices of ASCAP in New York.
I want to see the piano. We have Victor Herbert's piano.
I would really like to see that. I've been looking forward to this for quite a while.
And Michael Spudich is showing me a very precious memento of Victor Herbert.
The piano is just outside of the Victor Herbert room. And Guy is going to bless us with a performance.
Well, I don't know. I see this beautiful old sort of battered upright with a lot of character here. And on the facade, on the front of the piano, it says Victor Herbert, 1859 to 1924. It was upon this piano that he composed many of his most beloved works, a gift to ASCAP from his daughter, Ella, in 1935. Look at this. Wow. I'm just going to play Yesterthoughts by Victor Herbert.
By May 1924, Victor Herbert was one of the most famous musicians in the States. Despite a few recent flops, he seemed to be at the summit of his career. His most recent operetta, Orange Blossoms, was not a big hit, but contained one of his most famous songs, A Kiss in the Dark, which was an instant hit. And a new show, The Dream Girl, had just begun its pre-Broadway run in Connecticut. Herbert was slowing down a bit, but was by now a fixture in New York's cultural life. Also, he was wealthy, thanks in part to his founding of ASCAP. He was earning handsome royalties from his many tunes. On May 26, at the age of 65, he died suddenly of a heart attack.
The funeral cortege was humongous and had every band in New York, the police band, the fire band, the pipes, everybody. There was a Philharmonic contingency. There was a Victor Herbert contingency. It was a huge funeral and a shocking funeral because they were not ready.
Vast crowds gathered on Fifth Avenue for the march from ASCAP headquarters to St. Thomas's Church. After the casket came the clubs of which he'd been a member, the Lambs, the Friars, the Lottos, the Friendly Sons of St. Patrick, the Association of the Musicians of Greater New York, the American-Irish Historical Society, and the Bohemians. He was buried in formal mourning dress, naturally with his favorite green vest and tie. Victor Herbert was buried in Woodlawn Cemetery, New York. He was survived by his wife, Therese, and his two children, Ella and Clifford. Shortly after his death, the music critic Deems Taylor wrote that Herbert's popularity as a composer exceeded that of any other in America. Victor Herbert raised light opera music to a degree of harmonic sophistication that has never before reached. A statue was erected in Central Park, and in 1939, Hollywood paid homage to him in a film called The Great Victor Herbert. In 1940, the United States government honored him by issuing a postage stamp bearing his likeness. But his music fell out of fashion, and after World War II, was all but forgotten. Until musicians like those we have heard from in this program, Alyce Mott, William Butt, and David Brophy, began to perform and record his music again. And that's the end of the story of the Irish-American composer Victor Herbert. Except that it isn't. There is one more plot twist worthy of one of Herbert's operettas. A few years ago, Marianne Casey was researching an article about Victor Herbert, nationalism, and musical expression.
It just struck me, everybody said he was born in Dublin, but I could not find that anywhere, and there is no plaque up in Dublin anywhere, and it's the type of thing the Irish in Dublin would do, put a plaque on the wall to say, you know, the composer Victor Herbert was born here.
And indeed, if you look at the biographies written by Joseph Kay, Neil Gould, and Edward Waters, they all state that he was born in Dublin in 1859. And Victor Herbert himself declared to the audience at the Schubert Theater in March 1917, "I have spent the best part of my life in the U.S. I have been a citizen for many years. I think I am today a good American. But I was born in Dublin, and all of my forefathers were Irish." So Marianne Casey began researching and unearthed some surprising information about Victor Herbert's mother, Fanny Lover.
She was 16 when she got married, and she married the son of a family friend, Samuel Lover's friend, James Muspratt, his son Frederick, which nobody knew that at all. In any of the biographies of Herbert, you won't see that anywhere.
Fanny and Frederick had two children, a boy and a girl, but the boy died as an infant. Then Frederick went off to Australia for several years, and while he was away, Fanny had another son. That was Victor. This led to one of the first divorce cases ever reported in the
Yes,
this
That's is really this is the divorce time. From the Times of London in 1861, and it's here that Frederick He brought the case for dissolution of his marriage to Frances Muspratt on the grounds of her adultery. They had issue a son and a daughter. They lived very happily for 3 or 4 years. But when they were at Paris, a quarrel took place between them, and they agreed to separate. Mrs. Muspratt subsequently lived abroad, generally in Germany, with her daughter. Mr. Muspratt went to Australia for about 3 years. At the end of last year, Mr. Muspratt received information which induced him to suspect his wife's infidelity, and he caused inquiries to be set on foot. She was traced by a detective policeman whom he employed first to Freiburg, then to Paris, and afterwards to Havre. She was there overtaken in March last, and another child, besides the child of her marriage, was found to be living with her. Her husband and Smith, the detective, had an interview with her, at which she said she supposed he had come to take away his daughter, but thank God he could not take away the other child, for it was not his.
That child was Victor. Her husband divorced her, took away their daughter, and Fanny was left alone with Victor. She refused to reveal during the divorce case who Victor's father was, and we suspect that she never revealed, even to Victor, that he had a stepbrother who died as an infant, and a stepsister who was still alive. Here's an interesting footnote. There's an enigmatic poem that Fanny wrote and gave to Victor, suggesting that he might set it to music. What by day was long forgotten comes to me in dreams again. All that once my heart so treasured, ancient rapture, ancient pain. Then I wake, my heart appeasing, with the thought, all this is o'er. Yet a secret yearning fills me for the joys and griefs of yore. Herbert saved this poem from his mother all his life, but he did not ever set it to music. We can only speculate that the griefs of yore she is referring to may be the death of her first young son as an infant and her daughter being taken away from her after the divorce. There was yet another twist revealed when Marion did further research.
And she went looking for his birth certificate, and when she found it, it was on the Isle of Guernsey.
Yes, you heard that right. Victor Herbert, proud Irishman, was born in Guernsey. Alyce first learned of this when she went along to a lecture that Marion was giving.
I went to the Library of Congress to hear Marion Casey talk about Victor Herbert and Eileen. And she said at some point that Herbert had never set foot in Ireland. And my jaw dropped and I said, oh, come on. You know, every book I've ever read, every author I've ever researched has said Herbert was born in Dublin. Herbert said he was born in Dublin. I confess to be very disappointed. It took a while for it to sink in.
Wow. Well, I didn't know that at all. God, I don't know what that, I don't want to say to that then.
Really? I thought he was born in Dublin.
That's some yarn, isn't it? That kind of almost beats anything you'd hear in Eileen. Like, that's as convoluted as the plot of Eileen is. Maybe so strange. God.
So the reality of the fact is that Victor Herbert never set foot in Ireland. And it was a shock. Definite shock. And I'm sure that there are a lot of people in America who don't know it. Because he was the epitome of Ireland to America.
Just a week before his death, Victor Herbert said, I owe everything to my mother. Yet the likelihood is that she kept secrets from him all her life, and that she never told him that he had an older stepbrother who died as an infant, that he had a stepsister who was still alive, and that he wasn't even born in Ireland. But he was brought up by his mother, identifying as Irish. Does this change the way we view his Irishness?
You know, in some ways, it doesn't matter what his genealogy or pedigree is, because he absolutely was totally involved in the New York Irish community. He believed himself to be Irish. And he left a body of work that is clearly Irish.
You are who you think you are. And Herbert, without a doubt, considered himself Irish.
So Victor Herbert, composer, conductor, activist, wasn't as Irish as we thought. He never even set foot in Ireland. But all his life, he declared himself a proud Irishman. And when you hear music like this, you realize he couldn't have been anything else.